So for this exam two review, we've got question one. We got to express the quadratic function in standard form and find the vertex minimum value or maximum value. So this is from section 1.3, standard one and standard two. So anyway, we've got to move the one over. And then anytime you have a leading coefficient other than one, you got to factor it out. So it leaves x squared minus 4x. And then I'm going to close the parentheses so that I can include a value that completes the square. The formula is you take b and divide it in half, which makes 2. And then you square it, which makes 4. But remember, this is an equation. Whatever I do to the right side, I got to do to the left side. It looks like I added 4, but I really added 3 times 4, which is 12. So I've got to add 12. Write that a little bit. I got to add 12. So that makes f of x plus 11 equals the 3 stays factored out. That factors into x minus 2 squared. And now I can move the 11 back over and get f of x equals 3 times x minus 2 squared minus 11. So the vertex is the point 2 comma negative 11, and because the leading coefficient is positive, it means the parabola opens upward, which means the vertex is a minimum value.
One of the application problems from the homework in section 3.1. Ball is thrown with an upward velocity of 80 feet per second. Its height after t seconds is given by this formula. What's the maximum height attained by the ball? So if you look carefully here, let me rewrite this so maybe it's easier to see. This is the equation of a parabola. And since it's negative 16 t squared, the parabola, if it were graphed, would be facing upside down. And so the vertex would be a maximum. So without really stating it, what this question is asking is to really find the vertex. So it can be done the same way as this previous question. But there's perhaps an easier way or a quicker way. This was also introduced in lesson 3.1. There's a vertex formula. The opposite of b divided by 2a. But you got to remember, this is equal to the x value of the vertex. In this case, we don't have x values. We have t values. So this vertex formula is going to give you the t value of the vertex, where t is in seconds. So the opposite of b is going to be negative 80. And then 2 times a okay, and then this would need to be done on a calculator. Probably want to use decimals unless you want to keep it as fractions. It's up to you. You are allowed to use a scientific calculator. I'm going to be using this graphing calculator just because that's the one I have available, but you're going to want to use your scientific calculator. 80 divided by 32 is 2.5. And that's 2.5 seconds, remember, because this is the value of t. So the ball reaches its maximum height after 2.5 seconds, but the question is, what is the maximum height attained by the ball? So you have to take this 2.5 and plug it back into the equation for t. Again, probably be easier to just do this on a calculator. Negative 16 times 2.5 squared plus 80 times 2.5. This ball reaches a maximum height of 100 feet. Okay, this is another application problem from section 3.1. It's pretty much the same as the problem previous. Manufacturer finds that revenue generated by selling a certain number or a certain commodity is given by this function where revenue is measured in dollars. What is the maximum revenue and how many units need to be manufactured to obtain this maximum? Keyword here is maximum, and tying that back into this, you can see that this is the equation of a parabola, and since it's a negative leading coefficient, the parabola is facing upside down again, so this parabola has a maximum. And if we were to graph this, the x-axis is the number of units sold, the r-axis is, or the y-axis rather, or the r-axis is revenue. So how many units does it take to reach this maximum revenue? That's what it's asking. Again, I would use the vertex formula, the opposite of B divided by 2A. So negative 160 divided by 2 gives negative 0.4. So negative 160 divided by 2 times negative 0.4. Is 200. So since this is x, you got to remember this is number of units, so you have to sell 200 units to achieve maximum revenue. But what is the maximum revenue? So you got to figure out how much you're going to make if you sell 200 units, so you got to flip 200 back into the function. So it's 160 times 200 minus 0.4 times 200 squared. R to sketch the graph of the function. Same directions as on question 2. The way I instructed to sketch the graph of a function, pretty much three steps. Step 1 was to find the zeros. Step 2 is the y-intercept, and step 3 is the end behavior. So, for question 1, let's start with the zeros. This polynomial is already in factored form, so all we have to do is look at the factors to find the zeros. The zeros are x equals 1. That comes from this factor. X equals negative 1 comes from this factor, and x equals 2 comes from that factor. It's also important with the zeros to consider the multiplicity to determine whether the zeros or the x-intercepts cross through the x-axis or bounce off of the x-axis. To determine multiplicity, you consider the factor and the exponent that's applied to the factor. Each of these factors have an exponent of 1. That means their multiplicity is 1. Any factor that has an odd multiplicity produces an x-intercept that crosses. So all of these three x-intercepts, or zeros, cross through the x-axis. Okay, the y-intercept of any polynomial function, or any function for that matter, is found by letting x equal 0. So, if we place a 0 in for all of the x's in this polynomial, 0 minus 1 is negative 1, 0 plus 1 is positive 1, and 0 minus 2 is negative 2. If you multiply these three numbers together, you're going to get the point 0, comma 2 as a y-intercept. Now, the end behavior is determined by the degree of the polynomial. If the polynomial is written in this form, factored form, one way to find the degree is to consider the number of zeros with their multiplicity. There's three zeros, and each of them have a multiplicity of 1. Add up all the multiplicities, and you get the number 3. So this is degree 3. So what that means in terms of end behavior is one side of the graph is pointing up, the other side of the graph is pointing down. Which side is which is determined by the leading coefficient. The leading coefficient here, out in front of the polynomial, is 1. 1's a positive number. So that means the right side is going up, and the left side is going down. And this would be the same end behavior of a degree 5, or a degree 7, or a degree 1, any odd degree. It's going to have the same end behavior. So what needs to happen now, transferring this information onto the graph, we have x-intercepts of 1, negative 1, positive 2, and a y-intercept of 2, with end behavior, left side's going down, right side's going up, all three of the x-intercepts cross through, graph looks similar to this. Now, what you gotta realize on the exam, if this were a multiple choice question, then you wouldn't actually be graphing this from scratch. You'd be choosing the correct graph from a choice of 4. So what you would want to look for is a graph that has the correct zeros, the correct y-intercept, and the correct end behavior. Question 2 is a lot like question 1. Start by finding the zeros and the multiplicity. Starting furthest to the right, we have this factor, x minus 3. That's going to produce a zero of x equals 3. Now, if you look carefully with this factor, it has an exponent of 2 attached to it, or applied to it, which means it has a multiplicity of 2. Any factor that has multiplicity that's even is going to produce a zero that bounces. This factor x plus 2 is going to produce a zero of x equals negative 2, and since it has an exponent of 1 applied to it, that's an odd number, so odd powers produce x-intercepts that cross. This factor right here, normally when students think of factor, they think of a term in a parenthesis, and that's normally the case, but x to the third power is also a factor, and if you think about what value of x turns this factor into zero, that value is zero. So x equals zero is a zero, and if you look at the exponent that's applied to this factor, the exponent's odd, which means this one also crosses. Now the y-intercept, if you let all the x's equal zero, zero here, zero here, zero here, you don't even need to worry about these because zero to the third power is 0, and 0 times anything makes the whole thing turn into 0. So the y-intercept is 0 comma 0. And the end behavior again is determined by degree. When the polynomial is written in factor form, you need to add all the one way to determine degree is adding the multiplicity of the factors. So multiplicity 3, multiplicity of 1, and a multiplicity of 2. If you add all those numbers up, you get degree 6. Since it's even degree, the end behavior is going in the same direction. They're both either going up and up or down and down. Since the leading coefficient here is 1, it's a positive number. Both sides are going up. Left side's going up. Right side's going up. So thinking about a graph, we have an x-intercept of 3, an x-intercept of negative 2, and an x-intercept of 0, and that's also our y-intercept. End behavior, left side is up, right side is up. So, going from left to right here, trying to connect the pieces, the graph crosses through the x-axis at negative 2, right here. Okay. Now, when I instructed this during class time, I made it a point to test in between values, like negative 1, just to see how far down this graph goes before it turns back up. Again, if this were a free response question on a test, that's something you'd want to do. If this were a multiple choice test question, it really wouldn't matter. Just to keep this short and say, all right, it turns back up at some point, crosses through, at 0. And then eventually it's going to have to come back down over here and bounce off the x-axis at 3. Now, again, graphing this by hand and producing your own graph, these might not be exactly accurate. What happens here is the graph has a few turning points where it kind of goes up and down, bounces, and comes up like this. Knowing where these go up and down isn't super critical right now. Okay. All that really you need to know is how to find the x-intercepts, how to determine whether it crosses or bounces like this one, what the end behavior is. Okay. Question 3, we still have to do the same things as in question 1 and 2. Before we do that though, we have to write the polynomial in factored form to find the zeros. So, if you look at all three terms, the common factor in each of the terms is x, or in this case, negative x. If you factor negative x, you're left with x squared plus 2x minus 5. Now, this problem is slightly unusual in the fact that normally, when you're left with a quadratic factor, you'll be able to write that as the product of two factors simply by using simple factoring techniques. It turns out that x squared plus 2x minus 5 doesn't factor. So that could mean one of two things. This quadratic factor produces two irrational zeros that we would have to get in the quadratic formula. So they still produce x-intercept, because irrational numbers are real numbers. They're just decimals. Or this quadratic factor produces complex zeros, or imaginary zeros, that don't actually turn out to be x-intercepts. Both of those cases, we'd have to use the quadratic formula anyway. So x equals the opposite of b, plus or minus the square root of b squared, minus 4, times a, times c, all over 2a. Minus 4 times 1 times negative 5 is 24. So this is going to produce real numbers because we're not taking the square root of a negative number, but they are going to be irrational zeros, meaning decimals, kind of unusual decimals. We're not going to get integer zeros like negative 2 and positive 3. So to figure out what the decimal values of these zeros are, you need to figure out what the value of this expression here is. So this, the plus and minus means you have to split this up into two problems. Negative 2 plus the square root 24 divided by 2, 1.45, and the other one, negative 2 minus the square root of 24 divided by negative 2 is 3.45. So those are the zeros. And they each have a multiplicity of 1. Now the y-intercept, well actually we forgot one zero, but we found two. There's supposed to be three zeros, because this is a degree 3 polynomial. We found two zeros here. The other zero comes from this factor, right here. The only number or value for x that would turn that factor into zero is zero. So x equals zero combined with these other two. Those are all three of the zero. So now the y-intercept, if you let all the x's equal zero in this polynomial, you would get 0 minus 0 plus 0, which is 0. So the y-intercept is 0 times 0. The degree, or the end behavior, since this is degree 3, And the leading, well, in this case, the leading coefficient now is negative. So that means the end behavior switches. The left side is going up and the right side is going down. So for this graph, do a little teeny one over here. This graph, we have a zero at zero. And you know what? This isn't looking right. Divided by negative two. That should be a positive two. So that should really be a negative 3.45. We have 1.45 and negative 3.45. So there's all three of the zeros. There's a y-intercept right there. The end behavior is left side's going up, right side's going down. So all three of these zeros have multiplicity of one, which means they all cross through the x-axis. Crosses through. At some point, again, if you were doing this by hand, you'd want to check one of these in between values to see exactly how well this graph goes before it turns back up. And same thing here. You just want to find out when x equals one exactly how high the graph is. Question four, determine end behavior. This is another degree three. And since the leading coefficient is positive, you know the right side is going up and the left side is going down. But the way that you describe this or notate this is using x's and y's. So considering this piece of the graph here, the right side, if you think about points on the graph and traveling from left to right, x values are getting bigger and bigger and bigger, which means they're approaching infinity. And the y values are also getting bigger, which means y is approaching infinity. Similarly, on the left side of this graph, if you think about the points on the graph, okay, as you're traveling now in this direction, the x values are getting smaller and the y values are getting smaller. Order, they're getting more negative. So x is getting more negative, which means it's approaching negative infinity. And y is getting more negative, which means it's approaching negative infinity. So all four of those questions, question 1 through 4, section 3.2. Question 5, find the quotient and remainder using log of it. And this is from section 3.3. Okay. Now it says specifically to use long division, and even if we had the choice between long division and synthetic division, we'd have to use long division because of the divisor. It has an exponent of 2, any exponent greater than 1, and we've got to use long division. So, one thing that you want to look out for is missing terms in the dividend up here, or in the numerator, and it doesn't appear that there's a missing term, but it actually is. There's no constant at the end of the polynomial. Usually there's a plus 5 or a minus 10 or something out of here. So you have to have a 0 in there to take the place of the constant. So 6x to the third plus 12x squared plus 13x plus 0. And there's also a missing term here in the divisor. There's no middle term, so you have to have a 0x. Okay. Now if you consider first term and first term, 3x squared divided into 6x cubed, well 3 goes into 6 twice, okay. And x squared into x cubed gives you an extra x left over. 2x multiplied by 3x squared is 6x cubed. We also have to multiply the 2x throughout this divisor polynomial. So 2x times 0x is 0x squared, and 2x times 5 is tennis. The phrase I like to use is draw the line, change the signs, change all the signs. First term is canceled. 12x squared minus 0x squared is 12x squared. 13x plus negative 10x is 3x. And we drop down the next term, start again. 12x squared into, or sorry, 3x squared into 12x squared is 4 times. 4 times 3x squared. 12x squared, 4 times 0x is 0x, and 4 times 5 is 20. Draw the line, change all the signs. First terms cancel. 3x plus negative 0x is 3x. 0 minus 20 is negative 20. So this is the quotient, and this is the remainder. Question 6 is to find the quotient and remainder using synthetic division. So this is done by an upside down long division bar, and you have to check the dividend up here in the numerator to make sure there aren't any missing terms, and there aren't. And then we're synthetically dividing by the zero of the denominator, which in this case is 9. Okay, and start the synthetic division algorithm here, drop down the 1, multiply the numbers on the outside, 9 times 1 is 9, add the numbers on the inside, 9 plus negative 7 is 2, 9 times 2 is 18, 26 plus 18, it's going to be 44. It's never a bad idea though on these tests to check your math, so 26 plus 18. 44, 9 times 44 is 396 minus 386 is 10, 9 times 10 is 90, 90 plus negative 87 is 3. So that's for the quotient and the remainder. This is the remainder. It wouldn't be correct just to circle these numbers to say that this is the quotient. Remember, these are the coefficients of the terms of the quotient. If we started with an x to the 4th and divided by an x to the 1 polynomial, that means we're left with an x to the 3rd polynomial. So x to the 3rd plus 2x squared plus 44x plus 10, that's our quotient. Okay, question 7 is also from section 3.3. If this first part weren't here, and all it said was to evaluate P of 3 for this polynomial, you just replace all the x's with 3's and be done with it. And that's okay to do just to see what the answer is, but to get credit for this problem, you have to show that you use synthetic division and the remainder theorem. Now, the remainder theorem, well, let's first start with synthetic division here. 1, 4, 8. And 9. And when we're using the remainder theorem to evaluate a polynomial, you actually use this value here. So the remainder theorem states that whatever value you get as the remainder, that's what you would get if you plug this number into the polynomial. So let's see what we get. Three times 29, let's see. Maybe 87, better check that. Okay. 9 plus 87 is 96. So the polynomial evaluated when x is 3 is equal to 96. Okay, and just fair warning, if this is a free response test question, and all I see is this without any of the synthetic division and remainder theorem shown, and you won't get credit for the problem. Okay, question 8. Find a polynomial that has these three zeros, and it's got to be degree 3. So if you already have the zeros, your next step is to form the factors that would have produced those zeros. So if the 0 is x equals 9, then the factor itself is x minus 9. And similarly, if the 0 is x equals negative 9, then the factor is x plus 9. And if x equals 6, the factor is x minus 6. And this is polynomial p of x. My next task is to multiply these three parentheses together. So if you take the first two here, x minus 9 has x plus 9, and multiply them together, and you get x squared plus 9x minus 9x minus 81, which simplifies to x squared minus 81. And that needs to be multiplied with the x minus 6. Now x squared times x is x cubed. X squared times negative 6 is negative 6x squared. Negative 81 times x is negative 81x. And let's see, negative 6 times negative 81 is going to be positive. Let's see, 6 times 80, 486. Let's just double check this. 81 times 6 is 486. And that's the polynomial p of x. Okay, question number 9 is from section 3.4. It's only asking you to do one very specific thing. Just give all the possible rational zeros. Essentially, what it's asking you to do is give p over q list, and that's it. You don't have to test them to see which ones are zeros, because it says don't check. Just give the list of possible rational zeros using the rational zeros here. So the values of p come from the constant. The values of q come from the leading coefficient. So if p are the factors of 8, that means p is equal to plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 4, plus or minus 8. The values of q, since q is equal to 1, just plus or minus 1. So to take all the values of p separately and divide them by the values of q, dividing by q, since q is 1, isn't going to change any of the values of p. So p divided by q, plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 4, plus or minus 8. And that's all it was asking you to do, is give a list of the possible zeros, and there they are. Question 10, also from section 3.4, is asking you, from the graph, determine which of the possible rational zeros actually turn out to be zeros. So first it's saying, what are the possible rational zeros? So you've got to do the same thing that we did up here in question 9. So we need p, we need q. P are the factors of the constant, which is plus or minus 1. And q are the factors of the leading coefficient, which in this case are plus or minus 1, plus or minus 5. So then p divided by q, if we have 1 divided by 1, that's just 1. But then if we have 1 divided by 5, that's 1/5. So these are the list of possible rational zeros right here. It says use the graph to determine which of these actually turn out to be actual zeros. And remember, zeros are the same as x-intercepts. So we have an x-intercept here, here, and here. Do those match up with any of the values from our list of possible rational zeros? And obviously we have 1 and negative 1. And we have the 1 here. Now 1/5, about 0.2. So it's about a quarter of the way. And obviously it's a positive 1 because it's on the right side of 0. That looks like it is about a quarter of the way between 0 and 1. So according to the graph, we checked from our list of, so we didn't even have to do synthetic division to prove any of this. And those actually are the zeros. Now it doesn't ask you to do this, but if you wanted to be sure, you could do synthetic division on these to make sure you get a remainder of 0. Let me show you here. Subtract on the 5 and multiply. We get a remainder of 0, so 1 works, and it would be the same for the rest of the other two zeros. Okay, next question. Question 11, and this The next 7 or 8 questions pretty much are all the same type of thing. Find the zeros. Very important skill coming out of chapter 3 is to be able to find the zeros of the polynomial. It's pretty much the same process over and over again. It's just the polynomial is different, different zeros. This is a degree 4 polynomial, which means it's going to have 4 zeros. First step is to list the possible zeros. And that's your P over Q list. The values of P, remember, come from the constant 6. Well, in this case, negative 6. We got plus or minus 1, plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3, plus or minus 6. The values of Q come from the leading coefficient, plus or minus 1. So 1 divided by 1, 2 divided by 1, 3 divided by 1, and 6 divided by 1. Plus or minus 2, plus or minus 3, plus or minus 1, 2, 3, and plus or minus 6. Those are our possibilities. And possible rational zeros. So now we just gotta start testing. We're gonna start with positive 1, see if that one works. And it may be that you have to go through a couple before you find any that work. So it's just something that you wouldn't want to rush through. Looks like we got luck in the first try. X equals 1, which means that x minus 1 is a factor. The other factor comes from these coefficients, x to the third plus 6x squared plus 11x plus 6. Now we've only found 1 0, there's 3 to go. So we're going to go back to this list. The reason you have to refer back to the P over Q list is we have an x to the third reduced polynomial, and you can't use the quadratic formula on an x to the third polynomial. So I'm going to test negative 1. And now I'm going to test negative 1 on the reduced polynomial, 1, 6, 11, 6. And second try, we got lucky. X equals negative 1. So up here in this step, we had two factors, x minus 1 times this other factor. Now we've got an additional factor, so we have x minus 1, that came from this 0. We have x plus 1, that came from this 0. And then we have this reduced polynomial of x squared plus 5x plus 6. Now we do have a quadratic factor, so you have two choices. Either it factors into two more factors like that, or you have to use a quadratic formula to find the zeros. In this case, this quadratic factors into x plus 2 and x plus 3. So we have all four factors, x minus 1, x plus 1, x plus 2, and x plus 3, which means our zeros are x equals 1, x equals negative 1, x equals negative 2, and x equals negative 3. Okay, question number 12. Find all the zeros, and this time you got to use the zeros to sketch the graph of P. So, P over Q. Just to start speeding this up, you'd have to go through and list the values of P, then the values of Q, then divide them all to get P over Q, but it's just going to turn out to be for this one, plus or minus 1, plus or minus, oh boy, let's see. 80, we're going to have plus or minus 2. 3 doesn't go into 80, 4 goes into 80, 5 goes into 80, I don't believe 6 goes into 80, or 7, 8 goes into 80, goes into 80, I think 16 times. Yeah. 4 goes into 80, 20 times. 2 goes into 80, 40 times. And 1 goes into 80, 80 times. So those are all the values, all the possible zeros, all the possible rational zeros of this polynomial. So we've got to go through and check them. So we'll start with 1 here. say that one didn't work. We can try negative 1. That didn't work. This might take a while. Got a pretty good feeling here about positive 4. And we knew that because I knew what the answers were beforehand. But eventually you would have gotten there. So x equals 4. That also means x minus 4 is a factor, and these would be the coefficients of the reduced factor of x, or the reduced polynomial x squared minus x minus 20. And again, this is kind of nice, this quadratic factor, your x squared minus x minus 20, can be factored into x minus 5 times x plus 4. So the three zeros are x equals 4, negative 4, and 5. Oh boy, so on a graph, let's see. The reason I'm labeling these axes now is I'm going to label the x and y slightly different because we have a y-intercept of 80. So the y-intercept is 80. We have zeros of 4, negative 4, and 5. This is a degree 3 with a positive leading coefficient, which means the end behavior is left side is down, right side is up. All three of the factors have a multiplicity of 1. That's odd multiplicity, which means the zeros cross. So crosses through and comes up. And again, if this were a free response question, you'd have to plug in some of these values between negative 4 and negative 4 and 0 to find out exactly how high the graph is. It may turn up to go a little bit above the y-intercept and come back down. Crosses through 4, crosses through 5, matches up right about there. Okay, question 13, find the zeros. This one, values of p and plus and minus 1, 2, and 4, but now the values of q are a little different. We have a leading coefficient of 9, so it's plus or minus 1, 3, and 9. So the values of p over q, you've got to divide all the values of p by all the values of q. So 1 over 1 is 1. 1 over 3 is 1 third. And 1 over 9 is 1 ninth. I move over to 2. 2 over 1 is 2. 2 over 3 is 2 thirds. And 2 over 9 is 2 ninths. Then move over to 4. 4 over 1 is 4. 4 over 3 is 4 thirds, and 4 over 9 is 4 ninths. Those are our list of possible rational zeros. We'll do synthetic division to find some. And you would most likely start with 1 and negative 1 and then try all of the whole numbers. 1, negative 1, negative 2, 2. Just to save some time here, and because I know the answers, I'm going to choose negative 4. So x equals negative 4 is a 0. That means that x plus 4 is the factor. The other factor that comes from these coefficients, 9x squared minus 1. So, we're at a slightly different situation here. This quadratic factor He doesn't really factor using traditional factoring techniques. So you could use a quadratic formula, or you could recognize this as the difference of squares. This factors into 3x minus 1, 3x plus 1, if that's something that you can easily recognize. If not, one thing you could do, since this only has two terms, it has a squared term and then a constant term, you could set it equal to 0 and solve the equation. If you add 1 over and divide by 9, you only get x squared equals 1/9. If you square root both sides, then the square root of 1/9 is plus or minus 1/3. When you take the square root of a fraction, you square root the numerator and you square root the denominator, and don't forget the plus or minus sign. So we have our three zeros of x equals plus or minus 1/3 and x equals negative 4. Okay, question 14, more of the same, and and q over q, since q is just 1, if you take all the factors of p and divide it by q, which is just 1, then essentially p over q list is just the p list, which is plus or minus 1, plus or minus 5. So, we try 1 here. This is not looking good. Try negative 1. Not looking good either. Try 5. Okay, this isn't looking good either. We could try negative 5. Hopefully negative 5 is working. There we go, first try. So if x equals negative 5, that means that x plus 5 is the factor. The reduced polynomial comes from these coefficients. That's going to give us x squared plus 6x minus 1. And, shoot, this quadratic factor doesn't factor. And we can't use the same technique as we did over here because there are three terms in this. So, only choice is to use the quadratic formula. X equals the opposite of b plus or minus the square root b squared minus 4 times a times c all over 2a. Minus negative 4, that's going to be 40. And if we simplify this polynomial, the square root of 40 is the same as 4 times 10, or the square root of 4 times 10, which means the 4 is going to come out as a 2. So it's negative 6 plus or minus 2 square roots of 10 all over 2. And if you look at the terms in the numerator, specifically the terms in front of the square root, you can factor out a 2. Those cancel each other out. The 2 that you factored out cancels with the 2 in the denominator. So you have negative 3 plus or minus the square root of 10. And we already knew that another 0 was x equals negative 5. So the zeros are x equals negative 5 and x equals negative 3 plus or minus square root of 10. Oh, we're the same. Now I haven't been doing this for the other polynomials for two reasons: one, to save time, and two, because I knew it wouldn't work. But one thing that sometimes can happen if a polynomial has four terms like this one, is you can try to factor by grouping. Okay, so in this case, it actually does work to factor by grouping. If you look at this first grouping, you can take out an x squared, and that leaves you with x plus 1. From the second grouping, you can factor out a 25, and that leaves you with x plus 1. So both of these terms here, this term and this term, have an x plus 1 as a common factor. So if you factor out the x plus 1 from both terms, you're left with x squared plus 25. Now, the reason that these are called zeros is it's because we're setting the equation equal to 0. If this times this is equal to 0, that means this factor has to equal 0 and this factor has to equal 0. This one's an easy one over here on the left, x equals negative 1. This one here, if you subtract the 25 over, you get x squared equals negative 25. If you square root both sides, and x is equal to plus or minus, since you're taking the square root of a negative number, you have to use imaginary value. So it's plus or minus 5i. And those are the three zeros. X equals negative 1. X equals plus or minus 5i. Now number 16 is slightly different. We're going to do this process in reverse now. We already have the zeros. We've got to figure out what the polynomial was. We know it has degree 3. That presents a little bit of a problem here. They've only given us two of the zeros, x equals 3 and x equals 3i. So what's the third zero? Well, the very end of section 3.5, we talked about what are called conjugate zeros. If a zero is imaginary or complex, it always has to come with a pair. It never comes by itself. So if x equals 3i, then according to the theorem, x equals negative 3i must also be a zero. So those are the three zeros. Once you know where all the zeros are, the next step, this is like, I think it was problem number 7 or 8, towards the beginning of this review, you take the zeros and form the factors from which the zeros came. X minus 3, x minus 3i, and x plus 3i. Once you have the polynomial written in factor form, you need to multiply the two factors, in this case the three factors together. I would start with the two factors that contain the imaginary unit. So, use the distributive property, x times x is x squared, x times 3i is plus 3ix. Negative 3i times x is minus 3ix. And negative 3i times positive 3i is negative 9i squared. Now, the 3ix and the negative 3ix cancel. And you need to remember that I squared is equal to negative 1. So this negative 9 is really being multiplied by negative 1, which turns it into a positive 9. So now we multiply these two factors together. X times x squared is x cubed. And x times 9 is 9x. Negative 3 times x squared is negative 3x squared, and negative 3 times 9 is negative 27. Back to the old problem here of finding the zeros. I know it might be a little bit overkill, but it's just an important skill to have, so I put it on here a couple times, more than a couple of times. It's just got to be something, if you want to be successful on this test, you've got to be able to find the zeros of the polynomial. So, P over Q, plus or minus 1, plus or minus 11. So, let me try 1. And again, you want to make sure that you scan through the polynomial to check for missing terms. There aren't any. So, let's see. So we're that one. So we know that x equals negative 1, so x plus 1 is the factor. These are the coefficients of the reduced polynomial x to the third minus 11x squared plus x minus 11. But we've only found one zero. Because this is a degree 4 polynomial, there's a total of 4 zeros. We've only found one, so there are 3 more. Those 3 zeros are going to come from this factor right here. But we can use the same pure calculus. We've already said that x equals 1 doesn't work. I'm going to try that one again, so we can try 11. But synthetically dividing now on this reduced polynomial, so 1, negative 11, 1, negative 11. Let's see what we can get out of this. Looks like we found another 0. So we already knew that x plus 1 was a factor. Now we know that x plus 11, or x minus 11 is a factor. And then these are the coefficients of the reduced polynomial x squared plus 1. Now remember, ultimately we're finding zeros because we're finding values that make this polynomial equal 0. So if this times this times this is equal to 0, that means that x would have to equal negative 1, x would have to equal 11. That also means that x squared plus 1 has to equal 0. If you subtract the 1, you get x squared equals negative 1. If you square root both sides, you get x equals plus or minus the square root of negative 1. That's the definition of the imaginary unit I. So that counts as two zeros. These were the other two. X equals negative 1, x equals positive 1. Oh, sorry, positive 11. Okay, number 18 here. The values of p are the factors of the constant, so it's plus or minus 1, 2, 4, 8, and 16. The values of q in this case, since q is equal to 4, it's minus 1, 2, 4. So p divided by q, if we take the first value of p and divide it by all the values of q, we're going to get plus or minus 1. That's from 1 over 1. And 1 over 2, plus or minus 1 half. 1 over 4 is plus or minus number 4. Now we move over to the next value of p right here, which is 2, and divide that by all the values of q. So we're going to get 2 over 1, which is 2. Then we're going to get 2 over 2, which is 1. We already have that one right here. We don't need it again. We're going to get 2 over 4, which is just 1 half. We already have that one. Okay, we move to the next value of p. Just 4. 4 divided by 1 is 4. 4 divided by 2 is 2. We already have that one there. And 4 divided by 4 is 1. We have that one right there. Okay. 8 divided by 1 is 8. 8 divided by 2 is just 4. And 8 divided by 4 is 2. So we have those. 16 divided by 1. 16. 16 over 2 we already have as 8, and 16 over 4 we already have as 4. So that's the list of possible rational zeros. We need to choose some from that list and synthetically divide. I'm going to skip right over to 2. I have a good feeling about 2. X equals 2 was indeed a 0, which means that x minus 2 is the factor. The reduced factor is 4x squared minus 4x plus 8. It turns out that this does not factor. So we use the quadratic formula. X equals the opposite of b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4 times a times c all over 2a. So 4 plus or minus the square root of 16 minus 4 times 4 times 8. I would recommend, rather than trying some mental math on some of these problems, that check it on the calculator. 16 minus 4 times 4 times 8. Negative 112. Now 112 is 16 times 7. If you take the square root of 16 times 7, the 16 is going to come out as a 4. And then the minus sign is going to come out as an I. So this is 4 plus or minus 4i times the square root of 7 all over 8. Now if you look at the numerator, common factor there in the numerator is 4. And 4 goes into 8 twice. So we've got 1 plus or minus I square roots of 7 all over 2. So it cancels two zeros. We have the zeros of x equals negative 2, so the zeros are x equals positive 2. X equals 2 and x equals 1 plus or minus I square roots of 7 all over 2. Those are the three zeros. The last section in the chapter, in the 6th edition, is 3.7, in the 5th edition is 4.6. The directions are very detailed in that they give you most of the steps you need to take to graph a rational function. You can find intercepts, the asymptotes. I'm actually going to start with the asymptotes and then do the intercepts second. So the vertical asymptotes are the domain restrictions. X cannot be 1, so there's a vertical asymptote right there, x equals 1. X cannot be negative 3, so there's another one, x equals negative 3. And now the horizontal asymptote is found by comparing the degree of the numerator, which is degree 1, to the degree of the denominator, which is a little hidden. If you multiply this all out, you'd have a degree 2. So the numerator is smaller degree than the denominator. That means that the horizontal asymptote is the line y equals 0, right along the y-axis. Now the y-intercept is found by letting x equal 0. So if you plug in a 0 for all of these x's, you're going to have 2 over negative 3, it looks like. Negative 2/3 is right about there, so 0 comma negative 2/3. And then the x-intercept, or intercepts, if there are several, would be found by solving the equation in the numerator. In this case, x plus 2 equals 0. So the x-intercept is negative 2. Okay, now these vertical asymptotes mean that when a graph approaches a when a rational function, rather, approaches a vertical asymptote, it either approaches positive infinity or it approaches negative infinity. But it doesn't just stop and pick up somewhere else. That would be a piecewise function. So over here to the right side, for example, the behavior of these graphs is always very, very similar. Either the graph has a piece up here in this corner or it has a piece down here in this corner. It's not going to have both because it wouldn't be a function. It wouldn't pass a vertical line test. So we've got to figure out, is the piece down here or is it up here? So the way that we can tell is by, let's fix this here. I'm going to just plot a point and let x equal 2 for that. So if x equals 2, I'm going to change all the x's to 2, we get 4 over 2 minus 1 is 1 times 5, so we get 4/5. So 2 comma 4/5 is right about here. Now that one point is sufficient to determine that the entire portion on this side is above the x-axis. Okay. The reason I know, or that we can claim here, that the entire portion here is above the x-axis, if one point is above, and then all of a sudden some points are below, that would mean at some point the graph would have to cross through the x-axis somewhere here, and there isn't an x-intercept to allow the graph to do that. So if one point is above, at least on this side of that vertical asymptote, all the points are above. Using a similar type of argument over here to the left, if we tested -4, for example, with all the x's, then we get -2, -4 minus 1 is -5 times -1, we're at -2/5, which is right about here, and a similar argument. If one point is below down there, all of them have to be, they all have to stay below because it can't cross up above the x-axis. There aren't any x-intercepts here to allow it to do that. Now we have an x-intercept here and a y-intercept here. The graph has to be at least connected between those two points. We got to figure out what happens after. So for example, after the graph passes through the y-axis, it's approaching this vertical asymptote, so it has two options. It can either turn up and go up to infinity, or it crosses through and goes down towards negative infinity. Now, if we're saying that it's going to go up and go up to infinity, that means it would have to cross through the x-axis right here. It can't do that because there's no x-intercept right here, so it has to turn down and head toward negative infinity. Now here the graph crosses through the x-axis, and it has the same two options. Either it goes up to infinity or it goes down to negative infinity, but it's already above the x-axis. It can't turn down and go below it again because there's no x-intercept here. So this piece of the graph goes up to positive infinity. Okay, 23, last one. It's going to be much easier to consider this in factored form. X minus 3 times x plus 3, and then the denominator is x plus 4 times x minus 2. So, same steps. The vertical asymptotes are the domain restrictions in the denominator, so we have one at x equals negative 4 and x equals 2. The horizontal asymptote is found by comparing the degrees. Since these have the same degree, that's the case where you have to divide the leading coefficients. 1 divided by 1 is 1, so the horizontal asymptote is y equals 1. Okay, now the y-intercept is found by letting x is equal 0. I'm actually going to go revert back to the unfactored form. If all of these x's are zeros, then those all disappear. We get positive 9/8. So 0 comma 9/8. Now 9/8 is just slightly larger than 1, so it's right here. The x-intercepts are found by solving the equation in the numerator equal to 0. That's going to give us 3 comma 0 and negative 3 comma 0. And this one's going to be a little bit quicker to determine where the graph is because the horizontal asymptote is not on the x-axis. For example, right here, this one point is below the horizontal asymptote, so we know that this whole piece of the graph is going to be below. And then similarly, we can argue that over here on the left side, since there is no x-intercept anywhere over here on the left side of this vertical asymptote, the graph cannot be contained in this bottom corner because it would have to cross to the x-axis at some point, so it's a safe conclusion that this piece of the graph is in the top left corner. Okay. And here we know that at least the x and y intercepts have to be connected. Okay. As it passes through the y-axis, it's going to continue to move up towards positive infinity. It can't pass through the y-axis and turn down because it would have to cross through the x-axis again here somewhere, which it can. And then here it crosses through, and it has to stay underneath the x-axis now. It can't turn back up and come back up here because it would there'd have to be another zero here to allow it to do that. So that graph would look something like that.